Happy Valentine's Day. Yes.
Happy birthday. Happy Valentine's Day.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. So they've been plotting here. I'll have to share. So they were part of the plot. Thank you guys very much. Now I gotta eat some pizza. I'm starving. Okay, so we're going to be talking about, let's see, localized electrons versus delocalized electrons. Localized electrons meaning that they're around a single atom or they're going to be shared by two atoms, right? Delocalized electrons mean that they're going to be shared by multiple atoms. Now, the secret to this is resonance structures. You guys remember resonance structures? You'll be fine. We'll see. If you guys recall, I'll give you guys a simple example of a resonance structure. Do you guys remember sulfate? What is the electron configuration? Not the electron configuration. The Lewis dot structure for sulfate. Okay. So we have. Remember, we had to use the. You guys remember? What is it called? For this guy? Formal charges. You guys remember that? That's right. Okay. And then we know that if it's beyond the third energy level, it has the ability of having more than eight around it, right? So sulfur is able to have more than eight around it. Okay, so good. So this here is one resonance structure, right? The other resonance structure is this. Should have just done sulfite. Life easy. And then we have two more resonance structures, right? And the last one. There's like two more, but you guys get the point, right? Okay, so these are all different resonance structures, right? For sulfate. Now, a couple of scientists believe that really what happens is that at any given point, you have a molecule that is in this state, that is in this state, that is in this state, that's in this state, right? And because of that, you have all of those possibilities. Okay, and then you have so many molecules and everything like that. So technically you have one that's going to be in every state. Now that wasn't the initial thought, but really what happens is that we know that electrons are mobile, they're moving, right? They're able to be delocalized. And so rather than going around and drawing this guy, right? We can draw it like this. Okay, so we're just basically saying that the electrons could basically move from spot to spot. And if we sit there and we measured the average length of the atom from the other atom, that bond is going to be a little bit shorter than a single bond, right? It's going to be a little bit greater than a double bond, and they're going to be about equal to each other. Okay, you guys are with me so far? The little dot dots. Yeah, because well, we don't know whether it'll be six or four, right? So we'll just kind of leave them. And you understood that it would be compensated for depending on where the electrons are. Okay. Now, this is the same thing that is happening in organic chemistry, but is happening in a much crazier way, right? So we could get delocalization over four atoms. You get delocalization over, you know, sort of like what we have here, where it's over four atoms, but more in a linear fashion compared to that whole tree type of fashion going on, right? So these guys here, as I said, are considered to be localized, right? They're located somewhere, where these guys are considered to be delocalized, okay? Meaning that the electrons are moving from this structure and that structure, okay? Are you with me so far? Okay. And again, these guys would be resonant structures of each other. Okay. Well, we haven't shown the resonant structure of it, but you'd have one case and the other case. Okay. And we'll get to that here in a second. Okay. So benzene, we know that benzene has six carbons and six hydrogens. The way that we've drawn benzene is typically we draw it. Okay, I'm gonna really screw it up here, but that's all right. You know what I mean. Okay. Come on now. Double bond. Double bond, right? But we know that it has a resonance structure where the double bonds are switched to the other side, right? So in other words, we have this guy, Okay. So those are resonance structures of each other. And so in reality, the benzene ring is another example of where we could use that little dash, right? Where we could have drawn it like this. Oops. Okay. This is bad. It looks like I've been drinking a whole lot. Okay. Or often what we'll do is just draw it as this. Okay. Maybe I shouldn't draw it right in the middle of both of those. You sure you don't want it there? And then we draw that little circle. Okay, so that's also considered the benzene ring. It kind of represents the same type of structure that we're looking at. Now, we know that benzene has, in terms of degrees of unsaturation, it's 4, right? So in other words, you have those 3 double bonds in there. So if we decide to make our benzene ring and we decide to substitute it, let's say we decide to hydrogenate it, so we go through hydrogenization, then we have the ability of getting hydrogen and disrupting this guy, we could end up getting this guy and that guy, and we could end up getting several different possibilities, right? If we decide to add hydrogen onto it, substitutions. Okay. Getting ahead of myself. So you guys remember about the lengths of bonds? Triple bond, are they shorter or longer? Okay. Single bonds, double bonds, in between, right? Okay, so the double bond is going to be a little bit shorter than the triple bond. Triple bond is going to be the shortest, okay? And so if we sit there and we look at this, the benzene ring, this is the benzene ring. So we have short, long, short, long, short, long, short, long, right? And so you would assume that it'll be kind of cockeyed, right? Because you have short bond, long bond, short bond, long bond, short bond, long bond. Right? But we know because of resonance structures that that's not the case. You have all the bonds in between are going to be comparable. They're going to be almost equal. Okay, so like in this case, we have short bond, long bond, short bond. So do you guys remember bond strength? Bond strength. Bond strength. 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 Muscle strength. Bond strength. It's the mask, I know. Yes. So bond strength, you guys remember? Who's strongest?
Isn't it the triple bond?
That's right. It is the triple bond. Sorry, trying to get some water.
Wouldn't it be the triple bond, then the double bond, then the single bond?
That's right. That's right. Okay. What's that? My look made you question. Okay. So, God, how can you tell my looks? I have a mask on. Okay. Okay, so we know that in terms of strength, the triple bond is going to also be stronger, right? And so because of that, that's also going to play a part in what's going to be the most likely to be broken, right? So if we were thinking about the benzene ring, if they were, you have that short bond and that long bond and that short bond and that long bond, how do I say this? If that was the case and they weren't moving, they weren't delocalized, then we would have very defined products that would be generated consistently, right? And you're gonna have very defined products generated consistently, but if it was a short bond, long bond, short bond, long bond, short bond, then you would have that one happening at one point because it's gonna be easier to break the shorter bonds than it would be to break the long bonds, right? Which we know that's not the case. We end up breaking the double bonds and then rather than the single bonds. The bond, the ring structure still stays in place. Does that make sense? Okay. So here, if we decide to substitute, so we're gonna replace two hydrogens with bromines. So the two products that we're gonna get, we have two possibilities. We are gonna get these terminal bromines here, or we're gonna get terminal bromines at each end. Okay? Because we're just doing a substitution. We're just replacing a hydrogen with a bromine. We're not doing a hydrogenation. Or a, what would it be, halogenation. Now, if we're doing the same thing in terms of with a benzene ring, we have a couple possibilities, right? So we have the 1,3, we have the 1,4, we have the 1,2, and the 1,2. So this had scientists kind of recognizing that, okay, so if these are the different possibilities that we can get by the substitution, right? So obviously we must have electrons being delocalized, right? And so, Kuechel basically said, okay, so this is the benzene ring, and then when it's rapid, you're gonna get the formation of the hybrid, or the resonant, you'll get the formation of the resonant structure, right? Where the double bond has been switched from here to here, and then in equilibrium, you're gonna end up have the ability to get it back. So they're gonna be in a rapid equilibrium with each other, okay? So in other words, you're gonna have a mixture of both. Okay. So then if you have a mixture of both, then you're gonna have your three different possibilities forming, right? Yeah, no, maybe. So here, this is a benzene ring, and we're basically adding just the hydrogenation of it. And so we get cyclohexane. Right. So again, if we didn't have that movement of electron or delocalization of electrons, then you would break one of those bonds and you end up with a linear structure and no longer a cyclic structure, rather than the addition of hydrogen and double bonds. And so basically in 1910, they basically showed that it supported the fact that you have the movement of electrons, okay? And this is gonna be really important for a lot of things that we think about, okay? Now, We know that the angle between here is a 120 angle because it's going to be double bond, single bond, right? So you got three attachments. It's going to be a 120. It's going to be the angle between here. It's going to be the angle here, 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 and here, and here, right? So they're all going to be 120. It's going to be SP2, right? Three attachments, SP2. So that means that you're taking the S and 2P orbitals, right? What type of bonds do SP orbitals, SP2, SP1, what type of bonds do they form? Pi or sigma? Are you sure? Because you remember that SP2 means that these guys are basically hybrids, right? They're forming hybridized bonds. They're all going to be the same. Was that? Okay. Uh-huh. So I'm going to ask you again. So you're on the right track. So you said sigma? Yes, so that is correct. So we know that the hybridized bonds are only going to form sigma bonds, right? So who's going to be forming pi bonds? What's that?
Isn't it the triple bonds?
Well, the triple bond has two pi bonds, right? It has one sigma, two pi, right? The hybridized forms the sigma. Right? And you guys remember hybridized orbital? It's where we're putting the SP together to make a new set of orbitals, right? Recall that? Okay. So the P orbital forms the pi bonds. That's correct. Okay. And that's also going to be important because we want to make distinction between those pi bonds and the sigma bonds. Okay. And the hybridization, okay? So,
wait, Dr. Henry.
Yes.
The hybridization's based off the S and P orbitals?
That's how
I always thought about it.
Yep, but they're merged together to make a new orbital, right? And then those hybridized bonds are only gonna form sigma bonds.
Oh, okay. But they don't form the pi bonds?
No, they don't form the pi bonds.
Oh, I guess that's why I'm confused.
Yeah, because they're making that hybrid, right? So yeah. We know that the pi bond is always going to be like this. Where you have overlap and overlap. So
the pi bonds are,
that's right. Pi bonds are only going to involve the P, right?
Okay.
I guess P or D, you know what I mean. So it'll be.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so again, we know that double bonds are going to be shorter than single bonds. Clear. Okay. So the delocalized electrons, right? Or the bonds, the carbon bonds that are going to be between the benzene rings, since they're going to be kind of like a mixture of a double bond and a single bond, right? Because they're going to be the resonance structures. They're going to be shorter than a single bond, but longer than a double bond. Okay. because it's going to be somewhere in the middle. Okay. So strength wise, they're going to be a little weaker than a double bond, but stronger than a single bond. Okay. So the way that we depict the delocalized structure is like this for the benzene ring. And I showed you the circle already. So get ahead of myself. So here, the pi electrons are going to be delocalized. Okay, so if we take a look, these are your two contributing structures, where we have a bond between 1, 2, 3, and 4. So this is one resonance, that's the other resonance, and this is your hybrid resonance. Okay. Now, the way you guys kind of have to think about hybrids is going to be kind of like, here we have a unicorn and a dragon. So unicorn is one resonance, the dragon is the other resonance, and then the hybrid would be a rhinoceros. Right, because it has the little horn and the long beak of the dragon, you know, mixture between the two. Okay, so when we think about it, each of those resonances that are contributing, you're going to get that hybrid form. You guys have a look. Can you see it? Okay. Okay. So if we have triene. So in this case, because it's not planar, the structure is no longer planar. You have things that are not in the same plane. You guys remember what planar is? Planar, flat plane, right? Trigonal planar, right? Everything is in the same plane. Because this guy isn't planar, you have things that are in multiple planes. You have things are here in your X, Y, and then these guys that are, your Y planes here. These guys are in your X planes. And then I'm sure that we'll probably have, these guys would also be in your Y planes. Because these guys are no longer, they're not planar with each other, they're not going to have delocalized electrons because they're not in the same plane that they're able to sit there and move. Okay. Does that make sense? Well, it's a combination of, it's not only distance, this is going to play a part in it. And we'll talk about that in a minute. Because if it's isolated, then they're not going to, if it's, you know, so you're not going to have that presence in that case. But in the case of here, where we're talking about, because you have your p orbital, you have, do you guys remember you have pz, py, and px, right? So they have to be, for them to sit there and be able to exchange electrons, they have to be in the same plane as each other. So they both have to be py, right? Because if one is PYPX, we're not going to get anything happening, right? We're not going to get that exchange, okay? And so, but for them, they have to be in the same plane for it to happen, okay? So if they're PY and PZ, not going to happen. And because of that, because they're not in the same plane, you're not going to be able to get delocalization. So that electron isn't going to be able to sit there and move over to that other site because it's not transferred, right? It's kind of like doing this, right? So you're not going to have the electron that's going in this orbit here jumping over here because then that would cause havoc. Okay, they have to be in the same plane. It's kind of like, so if two trains, let's say one train runs this way, one train runs this way, right? And you have a person on this train, the probability of them, unless these trains hit each other, right, of them being able to transfer the train, it's going to be nil, right? But if the trains are running in the same plane, parallel to each other, they can just jump across, right? No problem. Well, maybe problem, but you understand what I'm saying, right? Okay. So here, these are your two resonance structures, right? So in other words, the electrons are moving from this guy over to this guy, and then we'll get our extra electron being kicked over here, right? So in that case, our resonant hybrid is going to be a combination of this. So both of these are going to be partial negatives, right? Because it's kind of sharing that electron being moved from one spot to the other spot. Can you guys see it, right? Okay, and you guys understand, you're understanding resonant structures. You're remembering, is this starting to click? Because that's gonna be really, really important. We kind of talked about it before and we kind of just kind of pushed in the water and said, okay, you gotta swim now, right? Now we're gonna talk about why it's the case. I'm gonna get you guys the background behind it. Okay, so in this case, delocalized electrons are gonna be resulting from P orbital. Of one atom overlapping with the p orbital of two adjacent atoms. Right? So in other words, the p orbital of this guy, well, p orbital of this guy is gonna be overlapping with this guy. The p orbital of this guy is also gonna be overlapping with that guy. Okay, so the electrons is literally moving from here to here. Okay. So, yeah, in a sense, it is kind of like a snapshot, you know? And so it's like, okay, it's here, it's here. So it's going to be moving back and forth. And because it's going to be moving back and forth between those two oxygens, right? Then you're going to end up with a partial negative charge to account for the full negative charge. Does that make sense? Are you good? Oh, no, it was because I was having trouble. I was trying to see, did you have trouble with it earlier? But they fixed it for me. Yeah. Oh, longer than this? So there's still problems. Yeah, well, it wasn't working earlier. And so then he unplugged it and plugged it back, and then it's working right now, but it'll probably go out in a couple of minutes. Oh, not today? No, I have not seen it. Okay. Okay, I will. Okay. So the electrons are going to be delocalized. So they're going to be moving from the p orbitals, right? So you have three p orbitals that are going to be adjacent to each other, and they're going to be moving from those three. So the p orbital from the nitrogen, the p orbitals from the two hydrogens. Okay. And they're just going to be moving. And again, they have to be within the same plane. Okay. So rules. So when you're drawing your resonant structures, your resonant contributors, electrons are going to be moving. Atoms are never moving. Right? So it's going to be the electrons moving, not the atoms. only pi electrons. So that means that the electrons only from the pi bond. That means that they're going to be coming from either p or d orbitals. They're never going to be coming from a sigma, right? Or the hybridized. Total number of electrons in the molecule never changes. And the electrons always move to an sp2 or an sp atom, not an sp3, because the sp3 can't accept any more electrons. Make sense? Okay. Somebody had a question. Oh, Abby, you're able to get in? We missed you. I was like, man, it's so quiet. Abby must not be here. Okay. Don't worry, we'll have a recording for you so you can take a look at it later on. Okay, so let's see what you guys can recall. So, who's going to be contributing to delocalized electrons or resonance structures? Okay. So, sigma bonds aren't. Okay, so we're only going to have pi electrons. Okay. So, if I have an sp3, compound or center atom, is that going to be a site for electrons? If I have an sp2, can that be a site for? Okay. So let's see. We'll see. See how much you guys remember. Okay. This guy, the center atom here, sp2 or sp3, sp1?
sp3.
Okay, so we know that this guy won't be receiving any electrons, right? Okay, what about this guy? So much trouble today. Okay, what about this guy here? What is its hybridization?
Wouldn't it be an sp2 since there's at least one pi bond formed in the double bonds?
Okay. sp2. Okay. What about this carbon here? The center carbon, this one right here. Also sp2. And then if we had this guy, would be, okay. Oh yeah, you guys can see if I circle. I have to remember to highlight the laser point. Can you see it now? Okay. So which one are able to have electrons move towards them?
The carbons with pi bonds?
The carbons with pi bonds. Yep. Nice word. Okay. Okay, so here's an example. So we have our pi bond, and since this guy is missing an electron, it has a, it is a carbon cation, carbon cation. Then we know that we can have an electron move towards it, right? So the electrons from the our pi bond here is able to move here. And then as a result, our resonance structure is, we'll get a plus charge here, and the double bond is going to be located between the other carbon. Okay. So these are resonance structures of each other. Yeah. So then in this case, the resonant hybrid is going to be a partial bond with the delocalized electrons between this carbon, the one, two, the second and the third carbon, and the third and the fourth carbon. Okay. Again, you guys can't see what I. So here and here. And so this guy, as a result, you're going to have a partial charge on the second carbon and then on the fourth carbon. Because it's kind of splitting that charge. Since the electron is being shared between the two sites for the resonance structures, between the two bonds. Does that make sense? So it's choosing this carbon because that carbon is able to accept electrons to complete its octet. Okay, so like for instance, since this guy is an sp2, okay, it's an sp2 because it's missing that electron, right? So if we let's draw it out, okay, because then it'll be easier to see. So we have,
between those two.
No, it's not going to choose that one between there, right? Because again, okay, so you have the carbon here. This guy already has its octet complete, right? So it has C, H, 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 where this guy has plus here, H, C, double bond, C, H, N, C, H, H, H. Okay, so this guy is going to be sp1. SP3, right? So it's not going to want to receive it, right? So it's not going to be able to go there at all because that one, its octet is complete, it's happy, right? So this here, that means that this one is going to go, I forgot the H, didn't I? Sorry, we got one H. Okay, so then this guy is going to go here to there. So then that way the electrons are going to move in here. This guy is going to become a zero charge. And then this guy is going to become plus charged. Okay, so and that's why we get this guy becoming plus charge and your double bond being over here. So the double bond isn't going to go where you're already happy, right? Where you're already at sp3, where you're already at your octet. Okay, so the electrons are not going to be transferred. Okay, make sense? Okay, so if we had, let's say, a double bond at the end here. So this double bond won't go to this guy because its octet is full already, right? So it's not gonna go there. Okay, so in this case, it won't be able to accept electrons.
Will it be able to move to the other carbon with the positive charge?
That is a good question. So, it would have a hard time moving over to the other carbon because it's hard to skip over that carbon to go there, right? So it would have to go through it, and it's not going to go through it.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's right. All the pieces are starting to fall together, right? Okay, so come on. Okay, so if we look at this. Okay, so here's our starting structure. We have sp2 here. So in this case, then the electrons are going to be able to be transferred here, right? So then we'll get this resonance structure where the electrons have been transferred from here, forming that double bond here. So now this guy here is now has a plus charge associated with it. So then this double bond that's here is now able to sit there and transfer its electrons over to that carbon cation. And then, so then this guy becomes plus, you have a double bond here, and you have a double bond here. So these are all three resonant structures. So this guy will be your resonant hybrid, where you have double bonds between, a resonant hybrid between your third carbon, your second and third, your fourth and fifth, second and third, third and fourth, fourth and fifth, fifth and sixth. Okay. Piece of cake so far? Okay. So if I have falling asleep on you. Okay, ran out of room. Okay, so we have something like this. What's going to happen? What's going to be one of the resonance structures? Okay. So we're going to have, yes. So we're going to move the electrons from here. Okay. So then we're going to get, I'm going to change the color to purple now since we're double bond. H. C. Plus, I've got my two here. H. Then so this is our one of our resonant structures, our resonant contributors. Okay, so then here. So then we're gonna get H.
So are we going to have like questions like how many resonance structures can we have?
From this, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, you will. Yep. Actually, let's see, was it going to be five? No, I think it'll be four. Yep. Yeah, because you're going to have this one is going to change. So this double bond here is going to move. And since this guy, oops. This is SP3, right? So nothing's going to happen with that one. So we'll have this one, and then when this guy moves, it's going to go, the double bond is going to go here. We have a single bond here. This guy's going to have a plus charge associated with it. Okay. So you have one more left. Can you see it? So this double bond here is going to go here. And we're going to end up with, I'm going to write it up top, CH3, H, plus, H, double bond, H, H, H. Okay. So those are going to be your four resonance structures. So then you'll have a double bond. So between here, 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 here. So if you added it all up, then you're going to end up with, it's just a longer chain, but it'll be a partial structure here. I mean, a delocalized structure here, delocalized electrons here, delocalized electrons here, 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 and here. Okay, so let's see. CH3, CH, and then we're going to have delocalized. H, delocalized, H, one, two, three, four, five, six. And where would the partial charges be? So if this is the first carbon, where would all our partial charges be? First one was going to be here. Sit on the third carbon. So are you sure? So wouldn't it be one here on our second carbon? And then, okay, so that's fourth. so that accounts for this one. That accounts for this one. And then what about this one? And then the eighth, right? Okay. Good, good. Okay, good. Okay. Two more slides, and then we'll call it a day, I think. Let's see. Okay. Yeah, carry away. We'll come back to this one. Because I forgot. Let's see. Okay, so so the moving of lone pair electrons to the sp hybridization. So here, this guy is a sp2, right? So then we're going to be moving the electrons from the amine group, okay? And then it's going to be moved from the double bond to the oxygen. So in this case, we're going to end up with a structure that has a negative charge here and a positive charge here. Okay. So then the resonance hybrid is going to have a partial negative and partial positive. Now, this guy here is sp3, so it can't receive where this one can, okay? Because this guy is sp2. Okay. This guy's sp, so we know it can recede, right? So in that case, we could have the electrons moving from the double bond to this single bond, since this carbon is going to be an sp, and then from the triple bond to the nitrogen. So again, this guy is going to give us a partial positive and a partial negative. We'll come back to the questions here in a second. And so when we're talking about proteins, so proteins are carboxyl on one groups and amines on the other, right? So here the amine is going to be transferring its electrons to that center carbon, and then the double bond on the between the oxygen and the carbon is going to be transferring its electrons onto the oxygen. And so in the case of our protein segments, we're going to have that happening continuously. So here, since we have alternating between the carboxylin and the amine end or the NN, okay? So this guy is going to be putting the electrons here. Here, so as a result of that, you're going to get a plus charge here and a minus charge here, right? So then when you have it, it's going to be partial negative here, partial positive here. You have that look. Okay. Okay. So what is going to decrease stability is going to be if the atom has an incomplete octet. So if you end up with something that has an incomplete octet, it's going to decrease stability. A negative charge that is not on the most electronegative atom. So if we had a negative charge on a carbon, that's going to decrease stability. A positive charge on the most electronegative atom. So we have a positive charge on the fluorine. That's going to decrease the stability. Separated charges, where you end up with something that is plus and minuses that are totally separated. So, not like the previous example, because when we take a look at when we're making use of the hybridized molecule resonance structure, right? So if we take a look at the resonance structure that's hybridized, that one, this one gives us partial values. So this guy is going to give us a partial value, where if they're completely separated and it's not a partial value, then it would be considered unstable. Does that make sense? Okay, so let me give you examples of that and then we'll stop, because I know I'm ready for a nap already. So. So here, this is like carboxylic acid. So if the electrons from the oxygen is being transferred to the carbon, and then from the carbon to the double bonded oxygen, right? So as a result of that, we're getting a negative and a positive. Okay, now this has a twofer, right? Why does it have a twofer? Where's this positive charge at? What was that? What was that? We have the positive charge on the alcohol. There's a plus charge on an oxygen. Is that a electronegative molecule? Okay. So we have combination of separated charges, and we have a positive charge on the oxygen, right? So again, twofer in this case. So which is going to be more stable, A or B? Well, it says it up there. A is going to be more stable, right? And so in that case, this is what you're going to end up with, right? Okay. Now here, we have the oxygen here is going to transfer its electrons to the carbon. The carbon is then the double bond between that carbon and the oxygen. The electrons are going to transfer to the oxygen. Okay, so in this case, these guys are going to have equal stability, right? Because negative here, a negative there, right? Negative is on the most electronegative molecule. You guys know that this is just a hydrocarbon, it's just a chain of carbons, so. Okay. Come on. Okay, so here we have the double bond transferring its electron here, and then the electrons are being transferred here. So this guy has a negative charge. This guy has a positive charge. However, we have something that has an incomplete octet as a result, right? So which one is going to be more stable? Which resonance structure is going to be more stable? Okay. So here, electrons are being transferred from oxygen, then the double bond to this carbon. So then we end up with a negative charge on this carbon, and we end up with a positive charge on this oxygen. Which one is more stable? G or H? G. Because the oxygen has a positive charge on. Come on. Okay. So here in I, the electrons are being transferred from the negatively charged carbon here. And then the electrons are then transferred from the double bond to the oxygen. Okay. So then which one is going to be more stable, I or J? Why? Because we have a negative on the oxygen, which is the most electronegative, where we have a negative on the carbon here, which we know is, yeah, it's not as electronegative, it's less electronegative. So, stability, again, if the atom with the incomplete octet, negative charge, that is not on the most electronegative atom. A positive charge that is not on the most, I mean, a positive charge on the most electronegative atom, and a negative charge on the atom that is not the most, and then separated charges. Okay? Okay. So we'll stop at slide 29, and we'll pick it back up, and we'll start talking about delocalization energy. Questions, concerns, Kool-Aid? Wind up my phone. It's 27, yeah. I had some questions. I'm going to beat my kids. Yes, I am going to be putting up Kim 101. And you're also going to get your exams put up this week too. So it'll happen probably tomorrow. Practice exam is going to open up at the same time as the regular. So, and you'll have until, oh gosh, I'm going to give you guys until next Tuesday, because Friday and Monday are holiday for you guys. Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. Sorry. Wrong class. Wrong place. You guys don't have a holiday on Friday. You have a holiday on Monday. So I'll give you guys until Tuesday. Get it done. So, what's that? Yeah, it's President's Day. One of the President's Day. Yeah, I think it's Washington's, because Lincoln's was the 12th technically. And so they did it on Friday, this last Friday. Parnell did it the good way, where it's this Friday and Monday. They have off, so I'm gonna give them. It should be up tonight. I should have it done tonight. So yeah. Your homework is already, it's done. I just gotta post it. So practice, on the other hand, is up. Your practice is up. Your real is. And I hate when I do that. You should have done the practice first and did the real. But it's not posted yet. Neither are posted. So posted. Okay. Questions, concerns, cash, Kool-Aid? Okay. You don't have cash? Darn it. Well, happy Valentine's Day. You guys go be with your sweeties. I let you out way early.